Let's go ahead and kneel for prayer. Dear Father in heaven, we are thankful this morning for your intense love for each one of us. Thank you that you know us so personally, you could tell us exactly how many hairs are on our head. We can't understand that, but help us to accept that kind of love, that kind of understanding that you have for each one of us. Father, we are living in a world that's just chaotic, turned upside down, going crazy. The devil knows he has but a short time. Lord, in the religious world amongst us as a people, there is every wind of doctrine blowing. And you don't want us to be tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine. You want us to reach the full stature of a perfect man through Jesus Christ. That's what we want, Father. We want to be totally submitted to you, that only you would be seen in our lives. And we want to rightly represent you. We pray for the Holy Spirit this morning to give us wisdom, to plant our feet firmly and solidly upon your word. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, when I got done with the meetings in Australia, this very well-dressed, very handsome young man, he was probably, early 30s, nice-looking guy, well-dressed fellow, well-groomed. He walked up to me and he handed me a book after my last meeting on that Sunday morning in Australia, and he said, would you please read this book? He said, I think there's some new light in it. And the title of the book was The Fourth Kingdom Today. And I looked at the book and I said, well, when I think of the Fourth Kingdom, the only place in Scripture where you have a Fourth Kingdom is in Daniel chapter 7. Because you have the lion, the bear, the leopard, and then the nondescript beast. And that one's the fourth kingdom. And I said, and I looked at the guy and I said, if this author is saying that the fourth kingdom is happening today, then I completely disagree with it. Because Daniel chapter 7 is based in history. And when there is a prophecy that's based in history, you cannot apply it several different times. You can't do that, folks. It applies one time and one time alone. Now, before I go on, let me just say, we're going to look at this morning, Daniel 12. I know we've been studying Romans, but I know you folk are very merciful and very kind to me, and you allow me every now and then to divert from Tabitha, bring up Romans 11. Let's go through it. Nellie just shook her head and said, I could not go over Daniel 12 this morning. You're precious, Nellie. We're going to take a little diversion this morning and look in Daniel chapter 12. Folk, there is every wind blowing out there. And I told this guy, and he said, well, please just read the book. So when I was traveling from Brisbane to Los Angeles, I started looking at the book and got through about 100 pages. And when I got to there, I thought, man, there's so much confusion in this book. I'm not reading anymore. And I just closed it up. And when I got into Detroit, I found a circular file and made a deposit. So I emailed the guy back over in Australia, and I said, the guy did what I thought he would do. And the guy emailed me back and said, well, you obviously didn't read it, because Ellen White says that the visions that took place around the Yulai River are going to have, you know, are going to happen again. Well, folk, we need to be very clear on how we interpret what Ellen White says. Because I get people that take Ellen White's statements and they, you know, some people say Ellen White has a rubber nose, meaning you can twist her nose whichever way you want and you can make her say whatever you want her to say. So we've got to be very careful how we apply what Ellen White says. Very careful. She doesn't have a rubber nose. She knew exactly what she believed. And she was very clear on how she expressed it. She didn't have any trouble with communication skills. So I get letters all the time. The folk in Australia, this comes from everywhere. It has to do with Daniel chapter 12. And I want us to be clear on this morning. I just opened a letter yesterday from Australia, from a lady over there, and she said, I got this information in the mail, and the lady seems very clear on Daniel chapter 12, and she said, but I'm not real sure. What do you think? Well, I thought, I think it's time I put one on a DVD so I could send it to her and send it to a lot of other people that have asked me to do this. So we're going to analyze Daniel chapter 12 this morning and see if we can understand what this passage is saying to us. Daniel chapter 12. Go ahead, sweetie. Verses 1 through 3. Bible says, at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people. There shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered, everyone that shall be found written in the book. Many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, some to shame and everlasting contempt. And they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. Now, folk, these passages are just full of information. Number one, who is Michael? It's Christ. I had a guy argue with me about this recently at a fair. But Michael means the one who is God. Or like God. Yeah. That's who Michael is. And Michael is the one in Jude that contends with the devil over the body of Moses. And Michael is the one who raises Moses from the dead. Michael is the one in Revelation 12, 7 to 9 that wars with the dragon. Well, who only has resurrection power to raise up Moses? Who only can war against the devil and defeat him? Christ and Christ alone. Michael stands up, and then there will be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation. What event is this when Michael stands up? Probation closes, Dennis, that's right. Probation ends for all the world. Folk, don't get this crazy idea that there's second chances. There aren't second chances. When everybody's made a decision for God or against Him, that's it. That's it. It's over. Case is closed. Done deal. A time of trouble will then ensue on this earth. What happens during this time of trouble after Michael stands when probation closes? Okay, there won't be persecution. What will there be during this time of trouble? The plagues. Because see, prior to this, before Michael stands up, there will be persecution. And there will be martyrs. And maybe some of us in this room may be martyred during that time. Who knows? God knows. But this time of trouble will be when the plagues will fall. There won't be martyrs during this time. Because martyrs, as the great controversy says, martyrs are seed to bring people to Christ, to make people make decisions. But after Michael stands up and everybody's made a decision for or against God, there will be no more conversions.
So we're in the great time of trouble, right?
What's that, Louise?
You are the great time of trouble.
This is the great time of trouble. Okay. The little time of trouble begins when the Sunday law comes. Okay. That's when the little time of trouble begins. This time of trouble referred to here, this is after probation has closed. Then there will be the seven last plagues from Revelation 16, a time of trouble such as never was. Even to that same time, and at that time, thy people shall be delivered, everyone that shall be found written in the book. God will deliver his children. God will deliver his children. And what book is this referring to? Who's the book of life? People's names will be retained in the book of life. Now notice verse 2, Daniel 12, verse 2. Many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, some to shame. Thanks, Jimbo. Some to shame and everlasting contempt. What's that verse talking about? No. Okay, what resurrection is this? There's one word that comes in front of it. The special resurrection. Notice what happens here, folks. It says, many that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake. Some that awake during this special resurrection, some will awake to eternal life. But some who awake and are resurrected will go back to shame and everlasting contempt. This is the special resurrection just before the coming of Christ. Those that we read about in Great Controversy, page 637, those who died in the faith of the third angel's message will be raised up just before Christ comes to behold him in his coming. Okay? People like Ellen White, James White, J.N. Andrews, John Loughborough, S.N. Haskell, and many other faithful Seventh-day Adventists will be raised up just before Christ comes to see him come. But not only will they be raised to everlasting life, but some will rise up and they will go back to shame and everlasting contempt. Who are they? Great Controversy 637 again. It says, those who pierced Christ, those who derided his agonies, and those who were the most violent opposers of God's people throughout the ages. What's that, Eddie? Absolutely. Caiaphas and Annas will both be there, Eddie. That's exactly right. These people will rise up. Herod will be there. They will see Christ come. They will realize that they crucified the Son of God. And then Christ's very presence on his return will destroy them. You see? So they will go to shame and everlasting contempt. Yes, ma'am.
The ones that will rise up, the righteous, what happens to them after that?
Those that come up in the special resurrection, Nellie, they, Nellie, will see Christ come and then they will be raised up.
Okay, then prior to the rest of the righteous people being raised up.
Exactly. Exactly.
Now, is there a time limit involved in that, or is that going to happen close to the session, or how does that happen?
It's going to happen very close, Nellie. very close, because those who died in the faith of the third angel's message will come up right towards the end of the sixth plague, basically at the end of it. Then as they rise up, right after that, they will see the cloud in the east. They will know it's the coming of Christ. They will see him return. And then when Christ comes back, and as he gets very, very near to the earth, Christ then will say, "Awake, awake, ye that sleep in the dust of the earth, and rise." So then the righteous dead will rise up, Nellie. So there will be a brief time, but not very long. Not very long a period of time. All right, verse 3. "They that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever." You know, it's fascinating. The Bible refers to what is righteousness. There's two things in Scripture that are called righteousness. Number one is Christ. Christ is called righteousness. The Lord our righteousness. Jeremiah 23, 5 says that. Another way that righteousness is defined in Scripture, other than by Jesus Christ, it's by the law of God. Psalm 119. Next slide, sweetie. Psalm 119, 172 says, "All thy commandments are righteousness." So those that turn people to Christ and his law will shine as the stars forever and ever. Now, let's take a look at a little bit of this. This is comments on what we've just said. Michael stands up, probation closes. "Once everyone has decided for or against Christ, every decision will be sealed. Then the plagues will come," Revelation 16. Daniel 12 calls it the time of trouble. "Those who are one with Christ in submission to him will be delivered in this time of the plagues. Their names are retained in the book of life, having passed through the judgment found in Daniel 7. Verse 2 brings us down to the end of the plagues, when a special resurrection will occur just before the second coming. Those who are persecuted, Christ, those who persecuted Christ while he was here, and those who persecuted his people through the ages will rise to see Christ come. Notice Revelation 1:7. This talks about the very same event of the special resurrection. It says, "Behold, he comes with clouds. Every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him." Okay, so we have here another reference to a special resurrection just before Christ comes. Those who pierced Christ will be raised. The Bible is very clear about that. "All kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him, even so, amen. Some who followed Christ during horrible apostasy will rise to see Christ come as well." Notice the statement, Great Controversy, page 637. The Bible says, "Graves are open. Many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, some to shame and everlasting contempt. All who have died in the faith of the third angel's message come forth from the tomb glorified to hear God's covenant of peace with those who have kept his law. Those also which pierced him," Revelation 1:7, "those that mocked and derided Christ's dying agonies, and the most violent opposers of his truth and his people are raised to behold him in his glory and to see the honor placed upon the loyal and obedient." Okay, next slide, sweetie. A special blessing. There will be stars of God. Those who turn many to righteousness will be called the stars of heaven. A special blessing is pronounced upon those who turn people to righteousness. In the Bible, Christ and his Ten Commandments are referred to as righteousness. Okay, it's Jeremiah 23, 6. "This is his name whereby he shall be called the Lord our righteousness." Psalms 119, 172, my tongue shall speak of thy word, for all thy commandments are righteousness. Those who exalt Christ and his law will shine as the stars in the sky. You know, folk, most people in the world today want to uplift Jesus, which is wonderful. But in lifting up Christ, we must uplift his law. They must go together like a hand in a glove. Hand in a glove. All right, sweetie, next slide. Now, Daniel 12, verse 4. It says, but thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book even to the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. Daniel chapter 12 and Daniel chapter 11, right at the end of Daniel 11, refers to time. There's a lot of time mentioned in Daniel at the end of Daniel 11 into Daniel 12. This is the first reference in Daniel 12 and verse 4. Daniel was told in verse 4, shut up the words and seal the book. What book was Daniel to shut up and seal? What book was it? The book of Daniel. Daniel's book was going to be sealed up till when? To the time of the end. Okay, now when was the time of the end? We'll look at that in a minute. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. Now, folk, a lot of evangelists have quoted this verse and said, well, this is being fulfilled because we have microwaves and we have airplanes and we have jets and we have dishwashers and we have washing machines. That's not talking about that at all. It's not talking about scientific or technological advances at all. That's not what Daniel 12, verse 4 is talking about. I'll read it to you. Let's first off nail down the time of the end. When was Daniel's book unsealed? Great Controversy, page 356, tells us. You go back and read it in its context. I just pulled out the one sentence. Notice, but since 1798, the book of Daniel has been what?
Unsealed.
Knowledge of the prophecies has increased, and many have proclaimed the solemn message of the judgment near. Well, if Daniel's book was sealed up to the time of the end, and since 1798, the book of Daniel has been unsealed. Well then, folk, what is the time of the end? 1798. That's right. It's 1798. That's the time of the end. History records for us. Not only was Daniel's book sealed till the time of the end, which was 1798, but folk, from the time of 1798 down to, well, into the 19th and 20th centuries, there has been more understanding of the book of Daniel than there ever was in the history of mankind. Okay? More books, more magazines, so much light has come in understanding the book of Daniel since 1798. History records for us that as the 1800s dawned, understanding in Daniel's prophecies jumped exponentially. Countless books and pamphlets were written on the book of Daniel. Now, this is a statement from Great Controversy, page 360. It's quoting a man who traveled and was a missionary. His name was Joseph Wolfe. He was a Jew, a converted Jew, who preached in the Middle East, in Africa. He even spoke to the Congress of the United States prior to 1844 about the coming of Christ. This is what Ellen White quotes, Great Controversy, page 360. What this means, many shall run to and fro and knowledge shall be increased. Listen to what this says. This phrase here means, as it relates to the prophecies in Daniel, knowledge of them would increase. Prophecy has been fulfilled. Folk, this phrase right here, many shall run to and fro and knowledge shall be increased, it's talking about on the prophecies of Daniel. That's what it's talking about. It has nothing to do with airplanes and microwave ovens. It has strictly to do with the prophecies in the book of Daniel. Are we never to know that period while he himself exhorteth us not only to read Daniel, but to understand it? And in that very Daniel where it is said that the words were shut up to the time of the end, which was the case in his time, that many shall run to and fro, a Hebrew expression for observing and thinking upon the time, and knowledge regarding that time shall be increased. So this Daniel 12 verse 4 is simply saying, Daniel, your book will be sealed up to 1798. There will not be a lot of understanding as far as that book is concerned. But when the time of the end in 1798 begins, many will begin to understand the prophecies in Daniel. And knowledge about those prophecies shall be increased. Next slide, sweetie. Now, there's a little cartoon there. It says, no wonder it's not working. The main transmission limb is disjointed from the rest of the assembly. Well, you say, well, why did you put that, Bill, in talking about Daniel 12? Because, folk, Daniel chapter 12 does not go in chronological sequence. A lot of people today like to say, you see, Daniel 12 verse 1 is talking about the close of probation and the seven last plagues. And Daniel 12 and verse 2 talks about the special resurrection. And then the time prophecies that come after that, those take place in chronological sequence. No, they don't. No, they don't. Because, folk, if we say that, Daniel 12, verse 2, you have the special resurrection, which basically comes just before the second coming of Christ. So then all the time prophecies in Daniel chapter 12, if we say they follow chronological order, then that means the time times and half a time of verse 7, the 1290 of verse 11, and the 1335 of verse 12, those all take place after the special resurrection? No, they don't. No, they don't. Daniel 12 is not in chronological order. Portions of Daniel's book follow chronological order. Daniel 12 doesn't. Verses 1 and 2 looked at the close of probation, the time of trouble, and the special resurrection near Christ's coming. Verses 3 and 4 break this order with a blessing upon those who turn people to Christ and His law, plus a mentioning of the sealing of Daniel's book until 1798. That's a break in chronological sequence there. Next slide, please. Daniel 12, 5 and 6. Then I, Daniel, looked, and behold, there stood other two, the one on this side of the bank of the river and the other on that side of the bank of the river. And one said to the man clothed in linen, which was upon the waters of the river, how long shall it be to the end of these wonders? Now the man in linen was Christ. You say, well, prove that. Well, okay, let's do it. In Daniel 10, verses 5 and 6, Daniel saw a man. This was his description of the man. The same man he saw in chapter 12, but he saw him in chapter 10. verses 5 and 6. Daniel says, I lifted up mine eyes and looked, and behold, a certain man clothed in linen. Okay? This man up here, same man, clothed in linen. And Daniel gives a further description of him in chapter 10. His loins were girded with fine gold of Uphaz. His body was like the beryl. His face is the appearance of lightning. His eyes as lamps of fire. His arms and his feet like in color to polished brass. The voice of his words like the voice of a multitude. Well, this person here in Daniel 10, who is the same one he saw in chapter 12, looks exactly like the one that John saw in Revelation chapter 1. Notice the parallels. Head in Revelation 1, 14 to 16, his head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow. His eyes were as a flame of fire. Now, what did this say up here about this man's eyes? His face was as the appearance of lightning, and his eyes were what? Lamps of fire. Revelation 1 says, his eyes were as a flame of fire. Okay, same personage. His feet were like to fine brass. Well, let's see. What does this say? Daniel 10, his arms and his feet were like in color to what? Polished brass. Okay, same person. His feet were like fine brass as if they burned in a furnace. His voice was as the sound of many waters. Okay? This one, it said, the voice of his words like the voice of a multitude. So it had power behind it, folks. Power behind it. All right? Notice this. His countenance. What's another word for countenance?
Face.
His appearance, okay? His countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength. So it was a brilliant, brilliant light from the face of the one John saw in Revelation 1. What did this say about his face? His face was as the appearance of lightning. Same thing, folks. Same thing. And in Revelation 1, when John, before he saw this appearance of this person, he said, and being turned, I turned to see the voice that spoke to me. And he said, I saw seven golden candlesticks, and in the midst of the candlesticks was one like unto who? The Son of Man. The Son of Man. So John saw Christ in Revelation 1. Daniel saw Christ in Daniel chapter 10. Daniel saw Christ again. Daniel 12, 5 and 6. Same personage in every case. That's how Ellen White applies it as well. Next slide, sweetie. Now, let's notice this concept about the time. Because Daniel, as I said, Daniel 11, verse 40, and then Daniel 12 refers to time and the end several times. Let's decipher those. Let's decipher them. First off, Daniel 11, verse 40. The time frame for Daniel 11, verse 40, right smack into the book. Daniel 11, verse 40 says, and at the time of the end, shall the king of the south come against him, and the king of the north shall come against him. Okay? When did the time of the end begin? Okay, now, folk, I want to tell you something. We haven't been too far into this sermon. And I specifically this morning, after I got my shower and combed my hair, I got out two swabs. And I cleaned both ears very, very thoroughly. So I know that there's no clogging going on. Okay, so I'm going to ask the question again, okay? All right, when did the time of the end begin?
1798.
See? I knew my swabs did the job. I knew they did. That's right, it's 1798. 1798 was the time of the end. Mark that in your Bibles, right by Daniel 11:40. Underline time of the end and put in 1798. Okay, and don't let somebody bamboozle you and come along and say, oh, that means right down just before Jesus comes. No, it doesn't. No, it doesn't. All right, Daniel 12, verse 4. Daniel was told, shut up the word, seal the book, even to the time of the end. Okay, when was the time of the end? I'm going to let it slide this time. But that was pretty weak. That was pretty weak. Well, Louise, that was because your voice was the only one you heard. You said it loud, Louise, but some of the rest of them need to pick up the volume a little bit. Okay. Time of the end, 1798. Daniel 12, verse 6. The question is asked, how long shall it be to the end of these wonders? Okay? That one's not real clear. You say, well, that could be the very end of the end. In the context, you have the first mention of a time frame. You have a second mention of a time frame, time of the end. Both of them are 1798. Now you have reference to the end. In the context, folk, I'm going to say 1798. Daniel 12, verse 7. Christ tells Daniel it shall be for a time, times and a half, and when he shall have accomplished to scatter the power of the holy people, all these things shall be finished. Okay? Daniel 12, verse 8. O my Lord, what shall be the end of these things? Okay, again, just like verse 6. Not totally clear. Not totally clear. Daniel 12, verse 9. Go thy way, Daniel, for the words are closed up and sealed till the time of the end. What's the time of the end? 1798. Good. Good. We've got three clear references, folk. Three very clear references. We're talking about 1798 in this period from Daniel 11, verse 40 to Daniel 12, verse 13. Daniel 12, verse 13, it says, but go thou thy way till the end be, for thou shalt rest and stand in thy lot at the end of the days. Christ is telling Daniel, Daniel, your book will be understood, and you, your words will stand, your prophecies will be seen at the end of the days. Again, folk, clear reference to 1798. So of the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 times that you have time and end referred to, 4 of them are absolutely crystal clear. We're talking about 1798. The other 3 are not as clear. Next slide. The time of the end or the end of time. This concept is crucial if we're going to rightly understand the closing verses and chapter 12 of Daniel's book. 3 times the phrase time of the end is specifically stated. This we know already to be 1798. 5 times reference is made to the end. Is this talking about the very close of time? Okay, and then I quote Daniel 12, verse 13. And this was the comment. In this passage, the end is referred to as the time when Daniel's book will be opened. This is 1798. The focus of Daniel 12 is 1798 and the surrounding events and time prophecies. That, folk, is the focus of Daniel chapter 12. Next slide. Daniel 12, verse 7, I heard the man clothed in linen, Christ, which was upon the waters of the river when he held up his right hand and his left to heaven, and swear by him that liveth forever that it shall be for a time, times, and a half, And when he shall have accomplished to scatter the power of the holy people, all these things shall be finished. A repeat of the same time period is here specified. This is the 1260 years of papal supremacy through the Dark Ages, as we have seen in Daniel 7:25. Some believe this to be referring to literal time down at history's close. Now, if that were true, then the obvious question would be this. Can't God make up his mind? You know, we pride ourselves as Seventh-day Adventists when people say, well, we shouldn't be keeping the Sabbath. We should be going to church on Sunday. And our response is, I am the Lord. I change not. Isn't that what we say? Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. We say Christ doesn't change, right? That's what we say. Now, folk, think about the principle that we use to defend the Sabbath. Does it not apply here? Daniel 7, verse 25, it says, he shall wear out the saints of the Most High and shall think to change times and laws, and they shall be given into his hand until a time and times and the dividing of time, or half a time. And we apply Daniel 7:25 to the papacy and to what period in church history? Papal Rome, the Dark Ages from 538 to 1798. Good! That's good! 538 to 1798. We say that's where it applies in Daniel 7:25. Now, folk, we come over five chapters later to Daniel chapter 12. We have the exact same time period. Now, what does it apply to? Folks? It refers to the same time period from 538 to 1798. That's what it refers to. Next slide, sweetie. Daniel 12, 8 to 10. I heard, but I understood not. Then said I, O my Lord, what shall be the end of these things? He said, go thy way, Daniel. The words are closed up and sealed to the time of the end. Many shall be purified and made white and tried, but the wicked shall do wickedly. None of the wicked shall understand, but the wise shall understand. You know, folk, there isn't a person in this room or a person that will watch this DVD that doesn't have some problem in their life. We all do. We all have things that are challenging us today. We all do. Christ has one purpose. He wants us to make a decision. See, when Elijah came to the children of Israel and they were playing church, what did Elijah say? He said, how long halt ye between two opinions? He said, if the Lord is God, do what? Serve him or follow him. And if Baal, follow him. See, the message God has always sent to his children is, be for me or be against me. But don't play. Don't play. And folk, why do we have trials today? Why are things coming harder to us? Christ wants to purify a people. He wants us to be ready. He wants us to be able, when judgment goes forward and the seal of God goes forward at the time of the Sunday law, He wants to be able to tell all the universe, I'm sealing those people right there. Why? Because they have made a decision for me that will never change. No matter what the devil does, their decision is fixed for eternity. That's what God wants. God wants us to make decisions, folk. And we're either making decisions that are saying, Lord, You can have my whole life. Or we're saying, Lord, no matter what You do, I'm going to live in rebellion. I am going to choose to sin. I am going to choose to disobey what Your law says. Because I don't want You to be the Lord of my life. Folks, God, He wants to purify us. He wants us to trust Him. He wants us to trust Him because He's trustworthy. Because His love is greater than any love that could ever exist in this universe. That's why He wants us to trust Him. So that's why God is allowing each of us to go through trials that break our hearts. And when our heart gets broken, we say, God, how can You do this to me? You don't love me anymore. No. It's because His love is so intense for us. And He wants so desperately to save us that He allows us to go through that. Because He realizes, folk, the only school that you and I learn in, it's a school of hard knocks. Next slide. Daniel asks, what will be the end of these things? The answer is for him to seal up his book till the time of the end. This we know is 1798. Many will find power through Jesus Christ to overcome sin and have a pure character. While many today give lip service and live lip service Christianity, there is no mistaking the glorious experience of victory over sin. That is the delight and privilege of the Christian. Revelation 3 verse 5 says, He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment. And I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. Those who are walking with Christ will discern the times, but the wicked time servers will not. God help us to be among the lowly who follow Christ wherever He goes. Next slide, sweetie. Okay, now we're going to take a look at another time prophecy in Daniel chapter 12. Daniel 12 verse 11 says, And from the time that the daily, the word sacrifice, is supplied, it's not there in the original, from the time that the daily shall be taken away, and the abomination that maketh desolate set up, there shall be 1,290 days. Now, let's nail down a principle here again. The time prophecy in Daniel chapter 7, the 1,260 days, was that literal days or was it prophetic days? It was prophetic. Was the time period the papacy ruled then for 1,260 days or 1,260 years? What was it? It was 1,260 years from 538 to 1798. The time, times, and half a time in Daniel 12, verse 7. Prophetic time. Are we going to be consistent? Or are we going to be inconsistent? Are we going to say that God is fickle and from chapter 7 to chapter 12, God has now changed His mind? Come on, folk, be fair. Be fair with the passage. Be fair with the principles of prophetic interpretation. Be fair. Your soul depends upon it. Be fair with Scripture. The margin reads, in order to set up the abomination that makes desolate. With this reading, the text would stand thus. from the time that the daily shall be taken away to set up, or in order to set up the abomination that maketh desolate, there shall be 1,290 days. Next slide. This controversial verse is really quite simple. Some event would trigger the setting up of the other. The daily, or the committing of the people to the worship of Christ, would be supplanted by the worship of the one who sets up the abomination that makes desolate. Christ warned of the abomination of desolation in Matthew 24, verse 15. Jesus said, "When you therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, whoso readeth, let him understand." Now, the pagan Romans set up this abomination that made desolate in 70 AD when they took over Jerusalem. They set up their standard in the holy places, which extended some distance outside the city. Great controversy, the first chapter tells us that. I believe it's page 38 or 39. Their standard, the Roman standard that was set up in the holy places that Christ warned his followers about in his day, their standard had a sundial on it. Why? Because the pagan Romans worshiped the sun, among many other gods that they had. They still do. They still do. But they were sun worshipers. Pagan Rome worshiped the sun. The papacy continued this tradition by worshiping the sun as well in their exaltation of Sunday worship. Now, folk, Matthew 24 applies in history. It applied different times. It applied around the destruction of Jerusalem when pagan Rome set up the abomination that made desolate. But the papacy also set up the abomination that made desolate, didn't they? Because through the Dark Ages, they set up Sunday worship. And down here at the end of time, will the abomination of desolation be set up again? Yeah, it will be. When there's a Sunday law. When there's a Sunday law. Okay, next slide, sweetie. Here's a Roman standard right here for anybody that liked to see it. They had many gods. Many gods. Right here, there's your sundial right there. There's their sundial. But that was a Roman standard that they carried into every battle. Prior to the setting up of Sunday worship by the papacy by 538 AD, some significant event would occur prior to 538 that would guarantee Rome's rise at that time. Look at history. Daniel 12 says that an event would occur that would make it possible for the papacy to rise up in 538. Did something happen that made it possible for the papacy to rise at that time? Well, there are many, many history books that bring this out. Notice this one. At the moment of the Frankish conversion, it's talking about Clovis, a Frankish king. They were in constant danger from the Arian Ostrogoths, who had just got a firm hold upon Italy. Theodoric had not distributed the religion of, or disturbed, excuse me, I misspelled that, the religion of Rome, but a new king might arise who should try to force Arianism upon the whole of Italy. The Pope was overjoyed to hear that the newly converted Franks, under Clovis, had taken his form of the Christian belief. Clovis became a Catholic in 496. Clovis was ready to bless every undertaking of theirs as the work of God. Excuse me, the Pope was. if only it might be against the worse than heathen Arians. Thus began as early as the year 500 an understanding between the Roman papacy and the Frankish kingdom of Clovis, which was to ripen into an intimate allegiance and to do very much towards shaping all the future history of Europe. The event which intensified the fears of all the Arian kings and which left to each one little more than the hope that he might be the last to be devoured was the conversion to Catholicism of Clovis, the heathen king of the Franks. Clovis became a convert to Catholicism, and he put all of his army on the side of the Catholic Church. This was in 496 AD. Now, were there any pivotal battles that Clovis fought that turned the tide of history in behalf of the papacy rising by 538? Yes, there was. Next slide. Watch this. The next campaign of the Frankish king, Clovis, was one of far greater importance and success. He was set on trying his fortune against the young king of the Visigoths, whose personal weakness and unpopularity with his Roman subjects tempted him to an invasion of Aquitaine. It would seem that Clovis carefully chose as a casus belli the Arian persecutions of the Alaric, who, like his father Euric, was a bad master to his Catholic subjects. In 507, Clovis declared war on the Visigoths. Why the explosion was delayed until the year 507 is unknown. That the king of the Franks, Clovis, was the aggressor is certain. He easily found a pretext for beginning the war as a champion and protector of Catholic Christianity against the absolutely just measures which Alaric took against his treacherous Orthodox clergy. The spring of 507, he, Clovis, suddenly crossed the Loire and marched toward Poitiers. 10 miles from Poitiers, the Visigoths had taken up their position. Alaric put off beginning battle because he was waiting for the Ostrogoth troops, but as they were hindered by the appearance of a Byzantine fleet in Italian waters, he determined to fight instead of beating a retreat, as it would have been wise to do. After a short engagement, the Goths turned and fled. In the pursuit, the king of the Goths was killed. It was said by Clovis's own hand in 507. With this overthrow, the rule of the Visigoths in Gaul was ended forever. 507. How many years is that before the rise of the papacy? 31. 31 years. You add 507 and 31, you get 538. How many years is there between 1260, the one-time prophecy, 1260 and 1290? How many years apart are those? 30 years apart. 30 years apart. Next slide.
What was the reference
to
that? Smith's.
Go back, sweetie. X that one out, sweetie. There we go. Go to the next slide. No, the next. This one here, Louise, is Daniel in Revelation, page 325. This is Uriah Smith's book, and he quotes several historians about the significance of 508. 507, 508 AD. Next slide, sweetie. Okay, here we go. This is from Daniel in Revelation, page 328. This next quote. This disposed of the Visigothic kingdom, but there yet remained the League of Arian powers under Theodoric. Alaric had counted on the assistance of Theodoric, but the latter failed him. The next year, AD 508, however, Theodoric came against Clovis and gained a victory, after which he uncountably made peace with him, and the resistance of the Arian powers was at an end. Folk, in 508, Clovis went after Theodoric and Arian. Theodoric beat Clovis, but for some strange reason, Theodoric, instead of conquering Clovis, made peace with him. That's probably one of the first times in the annals of history that that's happened. The significance of Clovis's victories, the eminence which Clovis had attained in the year 508, and the significance of his victories to the future of Europe and the church were so great that historians cannot forbear commenting on them. Nor was his a temporary conquest. Talking about Clovis, the kingdom of the West, Goths and the Burgundians had become the kingdom of the Franks. The invaders had at length arrived who were to remain. It was decided that the Franks, not the Goths, were to direct the future destinies of Gaul and Germany, and that the Catholic faith, not Arianism, was to be the religion of these great realms. Folk, by Clovis's victories by 508 AD, it made it possible for the rise of the abominating desolator, the Roman Catholic Church, by 538 AD. And between 508 and 538 AD is a period of how long?
30 years.
30 years. And from the 1260-year prophecy and the 1290-year prophecy, there is a span of 30 years. Next slide, sweetie. Clovis's conversion in 496 to Catholicism and his subsequent victories over the Germanic tribes and his peace with Theodoric in 508 paved the way for the rise of the papacy in 538. Worship was transferred from Christ to the Pope. Taking 508 as the starting date for the 1290-year prophecy, it would extend to 1798. The focal point of Daniel 12 is the time of the end, which is 1798. Next slide. Daniel 12, verses 12 and 13. The promise, the blessing was for those. Blessed is he that waiteth and cometh to the 1,335 days. But go thou thy way till the end be, the time of the end, 1798, for thou shalt rest and stand in thy lot at the end of the days. Since the 1290 years began in 508, and the 1335 years are mentioned in the same breath with the 1290 years, they too begin in 508 AD. The 1335 years, if you add that to 508, extends down to 1843. And the blessing is pronounced upon those who follow Daniel's prophecies, see the time of the end in 1798, but come down to 1843. And the rise of a prophetic people called the Advent Movement. That's where the blessing goes, folk. It's for those who followed the timelines to the early 1840s. A blessing is pronounced on those who follow the prophetic reckoning to 1843 and see the fulfillment of prophecy to that time. Clearly, the two prophetic forces are identified by two time periods. The enemy of God receiving a deadly wound in 1798 and the rise of God's final people in the time frame of 1843. Next slide. Here's a chart, folk. Here is a chart of the time periods. The time, times, and half a time of Daniel 12, verse 7, 1260 years from 538 to 1798. Clovis 508 wins decisive victories that paved the way to the papacy's rise. The 1290 and 1335 years both begin in 508. The 1290 extends down to 1798. The 1335 extends down to 1843. Clovis in 508 paved the way for the papacy's rise in 538. The 1260 and 1290 year periods both end in 1798, and the 1335 ends in 1843. Blessed are those who stand with the people of God and follow God's prophetic hand down to 1843. Next slide. Folk, we have no idea. We have no idea the pressure, the forces of evil that will be brought to bear on God's people in the very near future. We have no idea. But you know what? If we never forget, if we never forget that God had and still has a people today that were called into existence in the early 1840s. Folk, that truth that God has a people on this earth will keep us in the days ahead. Because, folk, this world is going to let us know in no uncertain terms. We are hearing it today, and we will continue to hear that voice get louder and louder and louder in coming days and months in this world. And that voice will tell us that Rome is the church of God today. That's what the world is telling us today, folk. Pope Benedict, in a recent encyclical, said, there is no salvation outside of the Catholic Church. If you want to be saved, you got to be in the Roman Church. That's what he said. The Bible tells us that the deadly wound was given to the Antichrist in 1798. We better never forget that. And we better never forget that God raised up a people in 1843, 1844. And the people that carry that message and hold on to that message, that will carry them through to the New Jerusalem. Folk, let's hold on to that blessing that Daniel 12 has for us today. Let's kneel for prayer. Father, thank you for your word today. Thank you for the prophetic gift of prophecy that still shines in a dark place. Please strengthen us to study these prophecies, to be firmly rooted in your word, so that we can stand against every wind of doctrine that is blowing to seek to destroy our faith. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.